Hi, my name is Kyle Avery. I'm a medic in the Army and currently in the 2021 AMCAS application cycle. Today we're going to talk about how to use MSAR and how that can help you get into medical school. We will discuss the differences between what you can use without a MSAR subscription and what you can use when you are paying for an MSAR subscription. The seven things I would like to discuss today when using MSAR is the applications accepted section, where you can see if they accept in-state, out-of-state, Canadian, or international applicants. The second thing that we'll be looking at is matriculation data. That will address, are they accepting mostly in-state or out-of-state students? Are they public or private? And kind of what their data looks like for who's actually in their schools by year. The third section we'll look at is the MCAD section. That'll be the median and upper and lower 90th percentile and 10th percentile. The fourth section we'll look at is GPA. The fifth section we'll look at is coursework. What is the required coursework and what is the recommended coursework? The sixth thing we'll look at is cost of attendance. There is a difference between public and private schooling cost of attendance. And then the last thing will be the pre-medical experiences that the previous matriculants have had at that medical school. Today we're going to be talking about medical school admissions requirements for applicants, also known as MSAR. You can create an account and sign in. This is ran by AAMC. Once you sign in and create an account, you have three options. You can use a free account where you do not subscribe to MSAR for the 1 year or 2 year subscription, or you can subscribe. If you do subscribe, it's 1 year for $28 or 2 years for $36. This may be useful for you if you're a sophomore or junior and you anticipate not applying to med school for two more years and you just kind of want to see what medical schools you want to apply to. For me, I think it's worth the $28 or $36 to apply to MSAR because of the useful information that you get from them by subscribing to them. If you do not subscribe to them, there is information you don't see. That would be the median MCAT, median GPA. There's other specific information that you can't see, such as matriculation data and secondaries and things like that. As we can see now, I am under a subscribed account, so this median MCAT, median GPA now shows for me. I have access to all information. On the left hand side, I can look at filters to show that I am out of state, a United States citizen, a Canadian citizen, or international. I can even filter my median MCAT and median GPA. You can also look at application deadlines. My recommendation is to apply as early as possible. So in terms of application deadlines, I'm not sure that you would need that. You can look at class sizes if that's important to you. You can filter out public, private, urban, suburban, and rural. In the search bar, you can search whatever medical school you want to look at, or you can just scroll down. Here's the way that I use MSAR. If I looked at, let's say I look at Albany Medical College, the first thing I want to look at. So the first thing I look at when I look at MSAR and if I want to apply to a specific school is the applicants or applications accepted. You can see if they accept out-of-state applicants, Canadian, international, or DACA students. If there are exceptions or additional information that they want to provide to you, it'll be on this right side. Sometimes this will say something like no preference for in-state or out-of-state. Sometimes it'll say, yes, we accept Canadian applicants. However, you must have 20 credits to apply here, or it'll just say no. This helps you to filter out which schools you do and do not apply to. For example, I live in Virginia. If I was applying to New York medical school, and they said, we don't accept out-of-state students, I would not even apply there because I am an out-of-state student, they wouldn't even accept me. So I'd be wasting my time and money by applying there. The second thing I look at is the matriculation data for the first year class. This is where you can get a lot of good information from them. You can see data on who was interviewed and who was matriculated. You'll also see special programs like MD or PhD. For me, this is important because I can see if they truly accept in-state or out-of-state students, because you can see who matriculated. This becomes important when you're looking at in-state and out-of-state schools, because right now I'm currently looking at University of Missouri. This is a state school. when you look at this data, you can see that there are 109 out of 128 students that matriculated and they were in state. Out of state was 19. This comes out to something like 10%, maybe less than 10%. So if you are an out-of-state student applying to Mizzou, this would be good information for you to know. I'm not saying you can't apply to that medical school. However, I just want you to know that you have a much lesser chance of getting into that school if you're an out-of-state student. Right now, we're looking at University of Arizona, Phoenix. This is a public medical school. However, when I look at their in-state and out-of-state matriculations, they look almost even. So out of 100 students, there's 45 out-of-state and 55 in-state. And then I like to also look at verified applicants compared to interviewers. So you have a better chance of getting interviewed if you're in-state, just based on the numbers. However, matriculated, they do about 50-50%. I thought this was important because when I applied to this medical school, I am an out-of-state student because I don't live in Arizona. However, it seems like they would give me equal treatment. Now we're looking at St. Louis University School of Medicine. This is a private university. Many private universities don't have preference for in-state versus out-of-state. Some might, so I would look at their data and maybe even look at their school website to see what they say. This will show 22 in-state and 148 out-of-state that matriculated. This shows that there's a strong, I don't want to say a strong preference for out-of-state, but if you're out-of-state, you have a good chance of getting in. Many public schools have preference for in-state students. You don't necessarily need to be actually living in that state to be considered a resident. For example, I'm in the military and I live in Virginia, but I am from Missouri, so I'm still considered a Missouri resident. You can look at MSAR, or you can look at the website for the school, or reach out to their admissions committees to see what they determine in-state residency is. The next thing I like to do is look at the MCAT. This gives me a good idea of what most of their class kind of looks like in terms of MCAT scoring. This middle number will be the median GPA, This middle number will be the median MCAT score for the entire class. So 50% of their class has somewhere around 514 for their MCAT. This right section will be the 90th percentile. So the upper 90% of the class has a 520. And this bottom blue portion says 10th percentile. So that means the lower 10th percentile has a 509 on the MCAT. What this does not mean is the highest scorer is not a 520 and the lowest scorer is not a 509. They must be somewhere above 522 or 520 and somewhere below 509 because this is just the 10th percentile. So if you have a lower number than 509 or even a higher number than 520, you can still get into this medical school. Additionally, this is just 1 year. And each applicant is their own person. So if you're around this mark, you may still want to look at applying to this school, but this is just good information to know. I don't generally look at these section scores. The only time I would be concerned about that as an applicant is if I just did really good on all the sections and I did really poorly on one section. The next section I like to look at is GPA. GPA seems to be a lot more broad than the MCAT and other things. This is the same sort of graphing they use as the MCAT. So this middle number here is the median for the entire class. Lower number is the bottom 10th percentile and the upper number is the top 90th percentile. So to get into this medical school, you would need at lowest somewhere below a 3.61 and somewhere below a 3.66. And then the highest are about a 4.0. You could probably still apply if you had a lower GPA, just realize that most of their class is sitting in this area. The next section I like to look at is the required coursework. This will give you a good idea of what kind of courses they are needing. This could be good if you're planning what courses to take or what school to apply to. For example, biochemistry is recommended, but it's not required. At least 3 hours of biology is needed with lab. As we can see, calculus is not required. Computer science, all these aren't required. And then you can see all of physics, organic chemistry, inorganic chemistry, and humanities are required, and 12 credits for that. Other information I find that's important here is if they accept AP credit. So a lot of times people do AP credits for high school, and sometimes they'll accept them and sometimes they won't. Many medical schools look at online classes or community college credits differently. So many times they'll have this as it's case by case, or you'll have the green check mark to say, yes, we accept it, or no, we don't. You can always reach out, because sometimes the school doesn't update the MSAR data, so you can always reach out to the school when you're doing their secondary and see if they accept it. So now I look at cost of attendance. This will look different between public schools, private schools, and the difference on in-state and out-of-state. Right now we're looking at St. Louis University again. You can see that there's no difference for in-state and out-of-state because they're privately funded. So you can see that there's going to be no difference for you. Sometimes private schools are more expensive than public schools, but if there's no preference for out-of-state, you may have that as a advantage for yourself. If we look at tuition for University of Missouri, we can see there's a large difference in the total cost of attendance for an in-state student compared to an out-of-state student. This is usually because, again, they're publicly funded, so they have a preference for in-state students. So if you do live in Missouri, you will pay less than you do if you're out-of-state. This would be the advantage of applying to a home state or a state you have residence in compared to applying to an out-of-state school. The final thing I like to look at is the pre-medical experiences of the first year class. This will show you a legend of the last 4 years of the data collected by MSAR and what their student population has for the pre-medical experiences they've completed. Right now we're looking at Washington University School of Medicine, and the biggest thing that I kind of see from their last year is that 99% of their student body they matriculated this year, or at least last year, was 99% for research or lab. You can see that maybe they don't care as much if you are medically or clinically have had paid employment, because there's kind of a low percentage there, but 93% for medical or clinical community service / volunteering. So you can see that they want you to do community service, they want you to do clinical work. Physician shadowing, 92%. You put yourself at a huge disadvantage if you're applying to these medical schools and you don't have one of these things, specifically physician and shadowing. And then community service or volunteering, 83%. You can see they start caring less about things if less of their class is there. That's kind of the way I like to look at it. So you can make up for not having community service if you've had medical experience. But I don't know that you could really make up for not having research if 99% of the class has had research. So I like to use MSAR as a tool to guide your decision-making process when applying for medical school, but it's not the end-all be-all. If you are creating your list for medical school, here's how I would do it. If you have a dream school you want to apply to and you would just be amazed if you got into that school, I would go ahead and apply to those schools. As long as it's not like 20 schools or something, I would maybe make your dream list of schools like 3 to 5. And don't even look at any of the data. Don't look at the GPAs. Don't look at the MCATs. Make sure you have the minimum requirement of stuff. For example, Mayo Clinic has a minimum MCAT score of 508. So if you don't have that, they will not even send you a secondary. And then I would apply to those schools. And then next, I would look at the applicants accepted and see if they accept out-of-state students, international, DACA, or Canadian. After that, I would look at the matriculation data to see if that kind of matches, because sometimes they can say they accept out-of-state students, but there's a large number, like a huge number of people that they actually accept in-state compared to out-of-state. After that, I would look at MCAT and GPA to see if that's kind of where you're falling in. And then you can see if you have the required coursework for their medical school. After that, if it's important to you for knowing, look at the cost of attendance, and then finally look at pre-medical experience.